Holy Spirit, happy feast day.
S praznikom.
Feast of the patron saint of our land, which eventually hopefully the churches would be filled, as they would be in other countries, should be. We look to an example for all of us, one who responded to the call of God, one who was called to leave all that he knew, to go to a new land, much as Abraham had been called to go to a new land, not knowing what he would find there, not knowing what the people would be like, the land, the food, the spiritual life, anything. But he went because he was called. St. Herman, from his youth, had desired to be a monastic. And he was healed as a young man, cancer on his face by an icon, the Mother of God. He had great, great faith in the Mother of God. As a young man, he went to the monastery. Of course, we think that he spent time at St. Sergius Lavra. Eventually, he ends up in Sarov, where he is a novice with none other than Seraphim of Sarov. They're both novices together. Imagine that monastery. And their spiritual father was who we now know as St. Nazari, who ended up in Valam, and is the abbot of Valam, and St. Herman eventually followed him there. And after a few years at Valam, he was allowed to go live really in a hermitage in solitude. So he prepared himself for his way of life in Spruce Island, in a way that is really beyond most monastics, certainly beyond most people in the world, to be able to live in that kind of solitude and that kind of prayer. But when the Metropolitan asked for a group to go to America, because the Russian, of course, American company had come there, the merchants, and they had Russians there that wanted to minister in that land, they looked for the best monks that they had. They didn't look for committees and organizations and programs. They looked for the holiest of men that they had to send, which is what the church had always done throughout history. We can learn from that example. Programs aren't going to solve the problem. Holiness will. And he was one that was chosen, a man that was a hermit. And he said, of course, as a monastic would say, may it be blessed. And he went on an arduous year's journey across Russia. Imagine the length of Russia, especially the area that he had to go through. Very cold, very frigid, very harsh. And he ended up, of course, going across and landing in these islands and becoming a monastic there. The people, their hearts were ready for the gospel. I would say quite unlike modern man. The man of slightly over 200 years ago was quite ready. There were simpler people. There were people that lived in difficulties. There were people that had faith, not the real faith yet, but had a belief in something other than themselves. And they, in that first year, some of the reports say, those people, the eighth, went, baptized 7,000, and solemnized 1,500 marriages. It's an incredible number in our day and age. We're amazed if we can do three or four. But these people's hearts were receptive, much like the early people in the scriptures. They weren't a complicated people by technology and society and all the so-called information that they think they had. Proved useless in the secularism that took them away from God. They were receptive to God. And of course, St. Herman gave them everything they could want. He taught them horticulture, he tried to heal them, he certainly interceded with them before the Russian-American company. He was quite brutal to the Aleut people, the Aleutian people, terrible to them, and sought to manipulate them. It was so bad, in fact, that of the two that remained with him, of course, after Juvenali had been martyred, the two left and left Herman by himself. It was too much to bear. But Herman saw it as his call, and nothing was going to turn him back from what God had called him to do. But this man who came, yes, he came and developed orphanages. Yes, he taught the people. Yes, he took care of the poor and healed them and did everything he could to take care of those who were downtrodden and those people who weren't. He did have a ministry, a very public ministry, an active ministry. That came out of the life of Hezekiah. We have in Kodiak now, as a matter of fact, St. Herman's Philokalia that he used, and some of the spiritual books that he used. He got that after he arrived there. It had just been published after he got there. It's an amazing thing that while this was worked on, of course, for decades by St. Paisius Velichkovsky, he was unable to finish it completely in his lifetime, because what he discovered when he went to the Holy Mountain, not only did not everybody read it at that point, but there were sometimes five different manuscripts of the same text in Slavonic. So that presented him with a very big problem, which one was correct. And before his death, a good while before his death, St. Macarius appointed the St. Nicodemus of the Holy Mountain came out with the Greek philokalia. You would have thought this might have made him downtrodden, but it didn't. He was ecstatic that he had something to compare the Slavonic with now, what was more accurate, because the Greek manuscripts were more accurate. And so, before Paisios' death, even when he was bedridden, he could hardly move. He kept a candle going in his room and was constantly translating amidst lexicons and various dictionaries and everything he had around his room. The Metropolitan Gabriel of Novgorod came and knew about this work and desperately wanted to see it and asked him if he could have it to finish the work. And of course, he gave it to him to finish the work. The Metropolitan Gabriel is rather much a man of inspiration because, yes, he put great translators and academics on the work, people that knew language, philologists. He had to have that. But more importantly, he had this same amount on the committee of monks who were very simple and uneducated. And they asked him why this was so. These people did not know the language. He said, yes, but they know prayer. They know things you don't know anything about. And he kept him on that committee. And that really helped with the translation immensely because they understood what the words were supposed to mean. And this book, of course, took root, was published. And, of course, The Way of the Pilgrim came out not long after that in Russia, which, you know, had a tremendous impact on the people. Not only does it have other places in the world, but had a tremendous impact. And the people began to read the Philokalia, and it led to movements such as the Altina Elders and this great flowering in Russia and some of the monasteries, whereas in Greece, where it was first published, did not have quite the impact. Because they had just undergone, of course, the Greek Revolution and constant battles with the Turks. It was a different time in Greece. Now in the 1950s, it started to take root again. And of course, it's every bit as equal on the Holy Mount as it is in Russia. The point in all this historical note is St. Herman, this was his way of life, a philokalic way of life of Hezekiah, of inner prayer, of silence, of seeking the presence of God, the man who on that island said what was better to be with men or to be with God and angels. When people asked him if he was lonely, you could hear angels chanting from his cell. He was not lonely in the least. He was not distracted by his mind when he was in prayer because he had given himself life over to prayer. This is the man, of course, who went onto the merchant ship. The famous line, which I love to recite and will continue to recite because it's so vital for us. When he asked him what was most worthy of their love, and they said, of course, everything from a beautiful wife to a good job to my own ship to an education. And he said, what could be more worthy of our love than our Lord Jesus Christ? And of course they tell him this is self-evident. He says with great humility, these 40 years I have tried to serve my King and my God, and I cannot say that I truly love him. What humility. And he looks back and he talks to them about, can you honestly say that you pray at all times with ease, without distraction? Can you say that you love your neighbor without effort, that you love everyone? He told them, of course, the famous line, from this day, from this hour, from this minute, that is, seek to love God above all else and to seek to fulfill his holy will. And that should be the message of St. Herman for our lives. That we cannot do the active works that we think we can do, that we cannot help our families, that we cannot help our children, we cannot help our spouses, our friends, anyone, if we don't have a heart that is present with God, that is rooted in inner prayer, that is rooted in silence, that is rooted in the Jesus prayer, hopefully, and a life that gives us will over to God. We need to listen to St. Herman's words and look and say to ourselves, do I love God with all my heart, with all my mind, with all my soul, with all my strength? Do I love my neighbors above myself? And in any single aspect of our lives, whether it be from the smallest details, if those things are off in our lives, we need to change those things and reorient our lives to where everything in our lives aimed to that purpose of seeking to fulfill God's holy will and to follow his commandments. St. Herman, pray to God for us.